Our second speaker in this track is Harin Parandiga, a microservice and middleware designer at XLX IATA. This session will be focusing on building an event-driven architecture.
Hello.
Hey, welcome, Harin.
Okay, am I audible? Yeah.
You are audible. Can you share your screen?
Sure. Now you can see my screen?
Yep, it's up, yep. Can you go full screen? Yep.
Okay.
That's good.
Okay. I can start, right?
Yes, you can start. I'll go off the stage. We'll join you back after around 20 minutes into your session.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Prasan. Good afternoon, everyone. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Harin Hasyani Parandika. I'm currently a microservice and middleware designer at XLX IATA. So I'm also a Google Cloud certified cloud architect. So today we will be discussing about building an event-driven architecture. The agenda for today's discussion consists of four agenda. The first one, we need to know what is event-driven architecture, and then we want to know how is it helping our company, why we need event-driven architecture. And then we will go a deep more about Solace and what is Solace, what role Solace take in the event-driven architecture, or we call it EDA. And also at the last one, we can summarize our discussion. Okay, so in this digital modern economies, there are a lot of requirement that comes to IT regarding the we need to have connected things when we can connect everything in the cloud, in the IT platform, and also we need to have a faster B2B integration, so business to business, and we want to make it a real time. But with that requirement, there comes a challenge where we have a multiple technology, we have multiple protocol to connect it with each system. And also in the cloud era, we have a multiple deployment structure where most of the applications already in the public cloud, but some of them still on the premise for some reasons. That with these challenges, it makes integration becomes really complex, and it needs more development time. When we need more development time, it might make us missing our opportunity in the market. So that's why event-driven architecture is needed. To understand more about event-driven architecture, we need to know what is event. Event is actually all of the things that happen within and around your life. So for example, when you are hungry itself is an event. And then after you're hungry, there are reactions and you need to eat. Eating is an event. And then after eating, you need to drink because you are thirsty, of course. And that's another event. That's event in your daily life. But looking more into the technical way, what is event? Event is actually a notification change of state. So event have several characteristics. The first one is that event represent the change of state that interesting to the business. That's in the technical way, so it might impact to your company. And also event is already, is about record of something that has happened, and events cannot be changed. For example, if we take a use case in the commerce, we have an order created. Order created is one event. It's already created, means that it's already in the past and it cannot be changed. So you already ordered. Maybe you can unorder, but that's create another event. If you order created, order cancel. That's different event. After we created an order, there might there will be another event, chain of reaction. We need to pay. So payment create separate event. After the payment is finished, we need to notify the customer that your order is completed. Then we need to send notification to the customer. That is event. So what is actually event-driven architecture? Event-driven architecture is a software architecture paradigm when it moves around promoting the production, detection, consumption, reaction to events. That's event-driven architecture, or we call it EDA for short. So why there comes event-driven architecture? We need to understand the history of application system platform transformation. The first transformation that comes to mind is actually the monolithic to microservice. Earlier, in the first phase of RIT platform, usually we have a monolithic legacy platform where we put all of our functionality or feature into one big applications. That's called monolithic. With this kind of application architecture, there comes several challenges where scaling is really hard, we have no automation, we lack of agility. Then comes the first transformation, we transform it into a microservices. For example, when we have our, we separate its functionality into a smaller service. For example, here we have an order service to handle the order and then payment service to handle the payment. And also we have a notification service that handle the notification. With this microservice, we achieve we can do auto-scaling, auto-healing, and we can put more CI/CD to our system platform. But the question is, how these services integrate or talking with each other? The first common use of architecture in the microservices API-driven architecture. You see here that in API-driven architecture, everything will be based on API. API usually use a standard HTTP protocol, and also the interaction between services will be on synchronous interaction that create a strong coupled interaction. And also API-driven architecture usually using orchestration pattern. Orchestration pattern means that at least you have one services act as an orchestrator, where you orchestrate all of the functionality or the sequence of the features. So with this with this sample, we have order service where he called a payment service when we need to pay and then send notification after the payment finish. With this with this pattern or with this application infrastructure, there comes a downside where if you introduce one service called stock services, you need to do development in both sides. You need to create the stock service itself, and also you need to change the order service because you need to call the new service. So with this interaction, it's really hard to maintain SLA because with HTTP protocol, when you overload your capacity, the request that comes later will be dropped. You're gonna missing opportunity. And also, point-to-point communication can grow complex if you have a lot of microservice in your system. There comes in the next architecture called event-driven architecture. Event-driven architecture usually using event streaming with messaging protocol, standard messaging protocol, called an event broker. With this event-driven architecture, the interaction between services become less loosely coupled because its services interacted in a synchronous interaction model. Event-driven architecture using a pattern called a choreography pattern, where everything will be published on the in the event broker, and the services that needs the event to be processed later on just need to connect to the event broker itself. So we can have an audio service as a producer, and then we have a multiple service as a consumer to one event. With this kind of architecture, overload requests can be stored temporarily inside event broker. When then we can do a reply later on, so we're not missing any opportunity or any revenue in the overload capacity. So we already know that using event-driven architecture, we need a feature or a system called event broker. So what is event broker actually? Event broker, according to Gartner, middleware products that are used to facilitate, mediate, and rich transformation interaction of source of event and handler in the event-driven computing. So there are three types of event broker in according to Gartner. The first one is queue-oriented, that is basically based on queue and topic mechanism, where you simply just publish the message, creating queue for its consumer and routing the message from the producer to the customer. That is solely focused on. So the sample of this kind of event broker are Solus PubSub Plus, we have RabbitMQ and QTT, Azure Service Bus, etc. The second one is we have log-oriented. It's basically based on concept, append-only log of messages. Neither consumer nor the broker will remove the message after the message is being processed, after already processed or being consumed by the consumer. Because the message will be removed after a certain time of period or after it reaches a certain limit that we already defined. The example of this log-oriented frame broker is Apache Kafka, Amazon Kinesis, and etc. The benefit of this log-oriented frame broker is that we have a message replay, because is when you have a new consumer and then want to consume the old messages, that you can go back to the certain date and consume the message from that point of time. That's a message replay. The last event broker type is subscription oriented. It's actually born out of the need to support the cloud native function. So it's basically on the cloud and published by the cloud. The example of this subscription oriented event broker is Amazon Event Bridge, Azure Event Grid, and etc. So in this session, we will go explore more about Solace PubSub Plus. Solace PubSub Plus is actually a complete event streaming based on a queue oriented event broker that is using basic topic and queue. This is published by a company called Solace. There are three kind of deployment of Solace PubSub Plus. The first one is Event Broker Cloud, where it is a managed service and you just log in to the cloud console of Solace, and then you can deploy the Solace PubSub Plus Event Broker in a minute. And it's it can be deployed in the public cloud. It's a managed service. And you can have a free service available. So there is a developer version, and when you can create a free version. The next one is Event Broker software, when you can deploy the Event Broker in all of your preferable environment. For example, if you want to deploy in your on-premise environment, you can download the software and then install it and deploy in your environment in the on-premise. And also, if you want to have it in your private code and public code, you can. There is also a free production ready edition for this kind of event Solace PubSub Plus software. So the last one is Event Broker hardware, where it is a hardware appliance, when it gives you extreme performance and capacity and compact form factor with the operations and low TCO. Okay, that's a Solace PubSub Plus deployment option. So actually, what are the key features of a Solace PubSub Plus? The first one is topic hierarchy. Topic hierarchy is you can define a topic name using a domain level with several level of hierarchy. For example, we take a use case in commerce when your service publish even purchasing of a product. So you can, if the product is laptop and the brand type is HP, you can publish it into product/laptop/HP/is purchased. The activity is purchased. And then if the brand is different, for example, the brand is not HP, but it's Dell laptop, then you can publish it to product/laptop/Dell/purchased. So the benefit of this topic hierarchy is that Solace PubSub Plus has a topic wildcard where we can use star in the topic name for one level wildcard, and we can use a greater than for multiple level wildcard till the end. The sample use case like this: you already published events through these two topics, SP Dell purchase, but what your services want to receive all of the event regarding laptop purchase. So your service can just only listen to product/laptop/store/purchase. It will receive all of the information from both this topic. So also, if another use case comes up, you want to know what all of the product's activity. So it's regardless the brand, regardless the type, regardless the activity, you can just listen to product/store. So you can get all of these. This event published into a topic name with start with product/. That's one of the key features. The next key feature is event mesh. Event mesh is an architecture layer that allows event from one application in one environment dynamically route and receive by any other application that's deployed in different architecture infrastructure. For example, you have event broker on your on-premise, and then application published into the event broker on-premise, it will be dynamically route if there is a consumer that listen to the event broker on the cloud. So why Solace PubSub plus event message import is really good, great to have, because it's dynamic. So your application doesn't need to know where it will be routed. So for example, your application just need to know that it's published to the closest event broker. Event broker will do the routing itself based on if there is any consumer in the other event broker. It is open because Solace PubSub plus support multiple open protocols and APIs. It can support MQTT, it can support GMS, it can support MQP, and also it can support REST API. The next one is very simple because Solace PubSub plus provide a single management console for event orchestration and management. And also it is everywhere because like I explained earlier, Solace PubSub plus can be deployed anywhere. It can be on-premise, on private cloud, on public cloud. It's based on your preference. Okay, why event mesh is important? This is a sample use case. For example, you have your front-end microservice application on the public cloud, and you still have your backend microservice on the premises. For some reason, maybe for some regulation or latency, you still have some of your services in the on-premise. So your front-end microservices calling API to backend microservices, microservices store the log in the database, your data warehouse will pull the logs in a daily basis. So when a partner or internal application want to know or give a promo per transaction that happened in your system, what option do we have? The first option that we need to direct call the API to the partner of internal application. This option can be real time, it's really good, but it needs more development time because every time you have a new partner of new internal application, you need to do development. And then it will become complex because if you have a lot of partner and if you have a lot of internal application, then it's really hard to maintain, right? It's really hard to maintain. And because of the development time, it can make you missing your opportunity in the market. The second option we can, in the best, that we sharing file or sharing data to the partner of internal application. It's really quick because you don't need to do any development on your system, but it's not real time. So it's really give a very poor customer experience. And then what happened if we have event mesh with event broker, for example, we already installed Solace PubSub plus on the public cloud and Solace PubSub plus on premise. So both event broker Solace PubSub plus interaction with each other with a DMR, dynamic message routing. With this kind of architecture, if you have a new partner, just need to listen or connect to Solace PubSub plus with the preferable protocol that they like. For example, if you want to connect to REST, then you can connect to REST. If you can connect to MQTT, you can connect through MQTT. Another example, if you have internal application also, you can just need to listen to Solace PubSub plus on their on-premise using my GMS, MQTT, MQPP, MQP. With this architecture, you will have a faster delivery time, low complexity, because they only know that they publish or connected to the Solace PubSub plus, and it is real time. With these benefits, we can getting opportunity faster and we're not missing opportunity in the market, and we can serve a great customer experience. Okay, so to summarize our discussion today, why we need event-driven architecture? Because it's asynchronous. It allows resource to move freely to the next task and avoid any blocking to the other services. The next one is loose coupling, because service doesn't have to know which request will be forwarded to the other services, which service will listen to their events. And it's really easy to scale because it's loose couple, right? It's loose couple. You can scale it on your own because each service only focusing on their task. And we using event broker with event-driven architecture, you have a recovery support. Like I mentioned earlier, messages can be stored in the event broker temporarily. So if you have a service down, your message or your request will not goal loss, you can do recover the loss work by replaying the events in the event broker. But even though event-driven architecture giving you a lot of benefit or a lot of benefit, but there are certain times when API is still preferable. API-driven architecture still preferable when you need a time when request reply, and also if you need convenient support for transaction, and your API need to be available to the public, it can be hit to the from your partner or your developer in outside of your company, and also if your project is small or simple, because REST is much simpler to set up and deploy. Event-driven architecture is preferable when you have multiple systems process to do the same events, and you need a real-time processing with minimum time lag, and you have to process a complex event, such as pattern matching, aggregation, time windows, and also if you have high volume and high velocity of data. Okay, the last one, you need to consider SOLAS, PubSub Plus when you require a key-oriented event broker, because, and then if you want to have the flexibility on topic hierarchy, like I mentioned earlier with the product and laptop, and also if you want to have the luxury of built-in multi-protocol, and if you want to have a dynamic event mask with multi-cloud and, multi-cloud and hybrid infrastructure. I think that's all from me. I will give back to Prashant. Thank you.
Thanks, Harin. That was wonderful session. So you can switch off your screen. Haven't received any questions as such. Okay, yeah, there is a question. Is there any cons of using EDA?
There are any cons. Yeah, EDA, like I mentioned earlier, EDA and API-driven architecture. The cons is actually if you have your project is simple and small, it might you need to consider REST API to deploy your application. That's one thing. Okay. Another thing is you have a time-bound request reply transaction, then API might API type of application is still preferable.
Right.
Yes.
So one question I have is on, how do you find the talent to work on your team?
Talent regarding
the resource, the people. Yes, the people with the right skill sets.
Okay. The skill set for our team is actually pretty much standard. We need to have a developer who understand the logic. So from my point of view, the logic comes first, because the tools can be learned later on.
Right, okay.
Right, so as long as the people or the person have the great logic, then it will be received warmly, happily, and we can train the new people with the new technology that used by us.
Okay, right. You're not going by the tool knowledge, rather the...
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, even though if you have the tool knowledge is preferable or... it's a benefit for you, but it's not a main consideration.
Yeah. So I think this is one of the questions that the people who want to move into this API microservices space do have. I think, how do I get it? How do I reach that, get my dream job? How do I get to work on those?